joined with Scott Budnick. He is the president and CEO of One Community, which is a company specifically focused on content linked to issues around social justice. He is also the founder of the Anti-Recidivism Coalition, focused on criminal justice reform. And before that, he was the executive vice president at Green Hat Films, where they produced a few little-known films, the Hangover series. So, busy, busy man. So let's just jump right in.
Yeah, let's do it.
So you grew up in Atlanta, and you had your first introduction into the film world as an extra on the set of a movie. You were a prisoner of war.
Yes.
Tell us about that.
I was a freshman at Emory, casting director came to Emory and needed like 3,000 extras to be prisoners in a Civil War prison camp. So we woke up at 5 o'clock in the morning and ended up going down to like this farm where they built an outdoor prison camp. And I was a soldier and they put lice in my hair and I was with all the Emory kids and they bust us down. And at like 7 in the morning, they put us in the mud in like tents. And it was freezing and it was fairly miserable. And like, just when you think it couldn't get worse, the director, who was John Frankenheimer, said, cue the rain machines.
Oh no. Although that might rinse out the
lice. Was like 40 degrees and now it's raining on us. And like all the Emory kids are like, this, I'm out of here. And I was just like, I saw like John Frankenheimer like on a crane swooping down with the camera. And I'm like, this is the coolest thing I've ever seen. Like people get paid to do this. Like I was pre-med. I'm like, no.
No more. Bring on the lice and the rain.
Yeah, yeah. And I went to the casting director and said, I'd love to intern for you. And in that moment, I left being pre-med. I became a business major and a film minor. And here we are.
And that casting agent, that wasn't just anybody. That was the Cynthia Stillwell. And that, you know, that led to a pretty big role.
Yeah, it was pretty unbelievable. When I moved out to LA after graduating Emory, my first job was going back. She was in pre-production on a movie called Road Trip, if anyone remembers Road Trip. A huge, incredible social impact film. I went back and worked on that film, and it turned out to be Todd Phillips' first film, obviously Joker being his last film, worked on that film with him. Ended up, like, at first I was a casting assistant, and then he just started throwing me different responsibilities. Like, literally one night at 9 p.m., he's like, hey, Scott, we start shooting at 6 o'clock tomorrow morning, and I need a black college step team. Find me one, and he just walked away. I'm like, okay. How the hell do I find a black college step team at 9 p.m. in Atlanta to be on set at 6 o'clock
in
the morning?
Well, at least you're in Atlanta.
What's that?
at least you're in Atlanta.
Wait, exactly. Isn't that the truth?
That helps.
So spent the night at Morehouse in Clark, Atlanta, and found my black college step team, and they were there at 5:30 in the morning.
And then was The Hangover, which, you know, obviously grossed $1.5 billion around the world. What did you learn from that experience?
I mean, that was, you honestly, when you make a film, you never know what you have. You never know if anyone is gonna respond to it, if anyone's gonna like it. You think, like, it's like one big inside joke. You're laughing at Zach Galifianakis all the time, but there's no promise that is going to, like, the people are gonna agree with you, right? So, I mean, it was interesting. We were in Vegas for the first 4 weeks of shooting, and I was living in Caesar's Palace. So, like, you guys know what it's like one weekend in Vegas. Now imagine 5 weeks in Vegas, living in Caesar's Palace. And I think the fun with Todd is that, like, he's a writer-director, so much is great on the page. Like, the script is so funny. But he also lets the actors play as much as they want to play. Like, I remember, I think on our second week of shooting, was Mr. Chow's first day on set, Ken Jeong. And there was that scene where he jumps out of the car on Bradley Cooper, and it was written that he's wearing pants. And, but he's shirtless, but he's wearing pants. And so he came up to me, he goes, Budnick, I have a great idea. I'm like, what's your idea? He goes, how about I do it naked?
Yeah. And try that here.
Yeah. If you've seen Ken Jeong, like, he's the last person that should be saying, like, we should do that naked. But he's so, like, comfortable with himself that, like, I started cracking up. I'm like, let's go tell Todd. Todd started cracking up. So like, I had to get Warner Brothers to scramble to get a nudie release. I brought it to his hotel room at like 11 o'clock at night. I'm like, they're paranoid, like you have to sign this. And he signed it, and then we went and shot it. And the funny part about it is, the unintended consequences of it was, it was 110 degrees that day. And he was having to jump out of that trunk on top of Bradley Cooper. And it was, and what we didn't think of, what we didn't think of is, we didn't let any of the hotels that are around that area, like the Mandalay Bay that was right on that lot, know that this was gonna be happening. So someone called the cops on us, and the sheriff showed up and like they tried to shut us down. And it took a little bit of a negotiation, but it all worked out.
Got it.
So I mean, it really, to me, it was the combination of like having some really funny stuff written, but like Todd just never stops thinking. He lets them play, and we just had great folks. I mean, no one, if you remember that, no one knew who those three guys were when we were shooting that film. Bradley had been like the fourth lead in Wedding Crashers. Ed Helms was on The Office, and Zach, no one really knew.
Yeah, that created so many careers.
Yeah.
All right, so you're working on amazing films. You're learning from folks like Todd Phillips, which you're also finding time to volunteer.
Yeah.
And so you're teaching some creative writing classes in a juvenile detention center. Tell us how you got into that, how it impacted you.
One morning, a friend of mine who was working on Old School with us, another social impact film, invited me down to a juvenile hall in Los Angeles. And I went there, was like, okay, like that sounds like an interesting Saturday morning for 2 hours. And I walk into this juvenile hall, and the first thing I see is a 9-year-old shackled being walked by two officers.
Oh.
And so just the visual of a 9-year-old in handcuffs was enough to like be very jarring on a Saturday morning. And I then went into this unit, which was a unit for all kids that committed violent crimes.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a little intimidating. Walk into this unit, sit down in a creative writing class with 12, 15 kids who are all facing life sentences. And I turned to the kid right next to me. This is no exaggeration. I turned to the kid right next to me, and I said, how was your week? Are you doing okay? And he said, it was a really bad week. I just got sentenced to 300 years to life.
And how old was he?
15.
Wow.
And I said, what happened? And he said, I was standing next to my friend. My friend shot the victim in the butt. The victim was in and out of the hospital in a day. No real long-term consequences. And for standing next to the person with the gun, I'm going to prison for 300 years to life. I'm going to die in prison. And he was 15. And my reaction was first kind of in horror, because I knew who I was at 15 years old is not who I was at 25, is not who I was at 35, right? And so that was shocking to me. Second, I realized pretty quickly that if that was my kid, he would be out on bail, because we could afford it. And he wouldn't be sitting in that juvenile hall, and he would have the best lawyer. And for not touching the gun, he would get probation and be home. But because he was a poor kid of color, he was going to prison, had nobody. He was going to prison for 300 years of life. And as we went around that table and talked to all of those kids and heard their stories, it was foster care, where they have nobody that loves them. It was physical abuse, sexual abuse. It was domestic violence. It was watching parents beat each other up. And it was just very clear it was about hurt people, hurt people. And I said to those kids on that day, I said, this has been one of the most impactful mornings of my life. And I'm making the commitment right now that next Saturday I'll be back. I'll be teaching this creative writing class. And that was 2004. I still teach that creative writing class on Saturday mornings today.
So this really stuck with you, because you stayed in the film business.
Yeah.
But after Hangover 3, right, this is the height of your career. Anyone would sort of, you know, love to have that mantle. You leave.
Yeah.
And that's when you founded the Anti-Recidivism Coalition. So tell us about that change. Not many people would expect that to be a move you make at that point.
Yeah, I mean, I think sometimes you just gotta follow your heart. And I'd been working with Todd for 16 years. And we'd produced, I think, 11 films that he directed, or 10 that he directed, one that he didn't. I was on Hangover 3, and I remember, we're back in Vegas. So like, oh Lord, we're back.
Take off the pants.
We were on the top of a mountain, and our call time was 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and we were gonna be shooting till 9 in the morning. So I'm realizing, okay, we're gonna have a 16-hour day all night long. And while I was on that mountaintop, my phone kept ringing, and it was a kid that just got out of juvenile hall, or a kid that just got out of prison. Hey, Scott, I don't have anywhere to live. Is there any, can you refer me to some housing? I'm like, well, I'm on the top of a mountain in Vegas. No, I can't, but call this person. I remember like vividly that like the governor, Jerry Brown, called, and he's like, I'm thinking about doing this. Can you come tomorrow to be part of this planning group? I'm like, no, I can't, I'm on a mountaintop. And it really was that side of my life was bringing me so much more joy than just the work I'd been doing for 16 years. And so it was that compounded with, right after Hangover 3 came out, I went to see 12 Years a Slave. And I'm like, okay, I can't be making comedies anymore. I wanna make films that can impact people, but for now, like, I wanna start a nonprofit. And so I went to Todd Phillips after 16 years of running his company, being the president of his company, producing his films, and said, I wanna go and do this. And he was the most gracious person ever and let me write out my contract, and I went and started a nonprofit.
And what was your, when you started the nonprofit, what was your first goal? What did you want to accomplish?
I mean, I think what I realized very quickly is all of us are messaged about crime based on like every night on the news. What is the worst crime that happened in America? And a lot of the depictions of brown and black people are not the stories that I see, the incredible stories of kind of inspiring and hopeful stories. They're the worst thing that's choice that someone made in America on that day. And people get scared and they want their kids to be safe and they're watching the news and they're just like, okay, it's much easier to just like lock them up, throw away the key, than to believe that transformation and redemption is possible, right? So I realized right away that like I wanted to work with people who were incarcerated and formerly incarcerated to change the narrative about who they are first and foremost. And then it was about like, that's four-pronged, like create a community, a positive community of positive peers. When someone gets out of incarceration, there's this group to welcome them home and show them like how to enroll in college, like do all these things. Then it was, okay, let's provide direct services. And to me, what does the white Hollywood guy know about what folks need? I wanted to listen to them. So when I said, tell me the things you needed when you got out, I thought it was the first thing was gonna be a job. Mm-hmm. And when we did the survey, the first thing was housing. They're like, if we don't have somewhere safe to live, if we have to get out and go right back to the exact same household where these things are still existing, where the homies are still kicking, et cetera, we're never gonna be successful. So we listened to them and created incredible housing programs, mentorship programs, career programs. We have tons of people. That same day that I met David, who got 300 years to life in juvenile hall, I met a kid named Adam. And Adam looked like he was 11. His hands were shaking, he was so scared to be there. And he was going to prison for 6 years for a robbery. Mm-hmm. Again, a teenager as well. Yeah. And he got out and he called me and he said, Scott, you promised me you'd give me a job. At that point, I didn't have ARC. And so I said, funny enough, we're in pre-production on The Hangover. Come down, but you have to work your ass off. Like, you're gonna be the first test case. I said, show up at 6 o'clock in the morning. Kid was there at 4:30. He beat all the producers to work, ran circles around everybody, attitude of gratitude, like daddy didn't give him the job. So every day he was grateful, no matter like literally dig a ditch. It's like, okay, how deep, how wide? Like no complaining, no questions. And so Adam, as soon as the film was done, our prop master's like, this is the greatest guy I've ever hired. Nice. I'm putting him into the union. I'm taking him to Iron Man. He's going from $12 an hour to $48 an hour. Now Adam makes $150,000 a year. He got his four brothers into the union. So all five of them are making into the six figures, and they just bought their family a house. And so to be able to then scale that, right, have an organization where there's now 150 Adams in the film and television unions, where we have 300 people building the Rams Stadium and in construction unions, firefighters, we have probably 100 plus people that have graduated four-year universities and have gone on some to grad school. Like, to me, that was what we were doing. And I'll be honest, I took a 90% pay cut to leave the film business and start a nonprofit, and by far it was the best 5 years of my life. It still is.
Amazing. You've been really successful on the legislative front as well, getting 14 bills passed in California. Tell us a little bit about that and sort of when you got into that space.
So, I mean, what I learned, and it was just, to me, I didn't know anything, so it was just one step at a time. At first it was, okay, people are coming home, how do we get them housing to college in a career? et cetera. Then a couple of Jesuit priests came to me and said, we're trying to pass a bill that would end life without parole sentences for juveniles in California. We are the only country in the world, no other country in the world would sentence a child to die in prison except for the United States.
Wow.
And in California and throughout the country, we were still doing that. Half the kids, there's only 350 kids in California, half of them had not touched the weapon. They were accessories, and they were sentenced to die in prison. And so for 7 years, they were trying to pass this bill that would only give these young people the chance of a parole hearing after 25 years in prison, 2.5 decades.
Seems non-controversial.
And in 7 years, we were 2 votes shy every time. No Republican votes, 12 Democrats didn't want to look soft on crime, wouldn't vote. We went up there for one day, and we walk into the Speaker of the Assembly's office, and he controls all those people that aren't voting. Mm-hmm. And I walk in, and there's 3 hangover posters on the table, and a Sharpie, and a photographer. I'm like, oh my God.
Are you kidding?
And so I sign the posters. I don't sign posters. That's like that. I'm like one of 10 producers. Like, that's not what I do. But I'm signing posters. There, I'm like a big deal. And I bring folks that are formerly incarcerated. So we sit down. He's like, why are you here? I'm here on SB9. He goes, where are you with the votes? I said, we're too short. He goes, show me the list. He says, this is who I want you to see. He calls those 3 assembly members. We go to their office. We pass the bill that day after 7 years because of the stories of those who are formerly incarcerated. And after that, passed 14 more bills that affected 25,000 people in California prisons who were young and sentenced to die in prison. And
similar stories, these are bills that people have been working on for years.
Yeah, well, no, once we passed that 7-year bill, every other bill we passed that year. No bill, like we were able to, and the interesting thing is, when I went to tell David, 300-year-to-life David, that we passed SB9, he said, that's great that you did that, but that doesn't affect me. I got 300 years to life. I don't have life without parole. So then we ran the David bill the next year called SB 260 that affected juveniles who didn't have life without parole but had crazy sentences.
Yeah.
Affected 6,000 people. And David's sentence got commuted from 300 to life because of the bill, went from 300 to life to 25 to life. And then right before Jerry Brown left office, he commuted David's sentence to time served, and he now goes to the parole board in like 2 months.
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is great. That is great. And so it feels like in some ways your work is coming full circle. So you started in the film business and then got into this work around criminal justice reform, realizing the power of stories, Adam's story, David's story. And so now you've started One Community.
Yeah.
So I mentioned earlier it's a company specifically focused on content related to social justice. Tell us about what you're up to, what you're trying to accomplish, and how you got into this idea about storytelling as part of the solution.
Yeah, so when I left the film business, a few people reached out and basically said, like, you're leaving your biggest tool in the toolbox, like your ability to tell stories on a massive scale, like that's something you should not leave. That resonated with me. That same week I got that call, I went to a party and met the guy that led the political movement for marriage equality, like one of the guys that were involved in the political movement. And I was having the most interesting conversation with him, and I said, how do you go, I mean, if everyone remembers how hardcore the opposition was to gay marriage, like people were clinging to their Bibles and saying, this is not marriage. And I said, how did you go from illegal everywhere to legal everywhere over a 10-year period? And without missing a beat, he looks at me and he says, Will and Grace. He said, and then he says, Will and Grace, Glee, Modern Family, Ellen DeGeneres, and then on the movie side, Milk and Brokeback Mountain. Those things over that decade softened culture, right? Softened people's hearts. So if I was hugely opposed, once I saw these cute characters that were kind of funny, that were gay, but they were cool, and I related to them in these ways, that maybe I didn't support gay marriage, but my opposition was softer, right? And that really resonated with me because I walk into these prisons and see someone that's been judged based on the worst thing they've ever done in their life. And that thing ends up defining their entire being. And if I was judged by the worst thing, and I think any of us were ever judged entirely based on the worst thing we've ever done, let's think about that for a second. I did some dumb in college. some really dumb shit, that would not be good. And so, to me, anytime I would bring someone into a prison, a jail, or a juvenile hall, I don't care if they were a hardcore conservative, I don't care if they were law enforcement, I had a woman. This woman was like our biggest opponent when we went into the Capitol to try to pass bills. Her husband was murdered by two juveniles. Heartbreaking story, Maggie, whose husband owned a gun store, and two kids came to rob his gun store, beat him over the head with a pipe, killed him. She found the love of her life in a pile of blood and had to bury her husband. And Maggie was against us on everything we were trying to do for kids. Understandably, right? Like, I don't know if I could ever recover from that. I asked Maggie if she would come down to my class in juvenile hall and tell her story to the kids, because they have to understand the implications of violence, right? The consequences of violence. And she tells her story, and as she's weeping, telling the story of Ross, three of the kids who were in there for murder get up out of their seats, put their arm around her, and start crying with her. And she starts grabbing them. She then starts writing them as they go on to prison. And Maggie's one of my greatest supporters. I call her Aunt Maggie. But that idea...
she turned in that meeting, in that day.
She turned in that one day.
Gosh.
If she can turn, anyone can turn, right? And so what I realize is, like, when this becomes human, when it's not scary, it's not like murderer, gang member, like scary-looking, tattooed, brown or black person, right? And it became a human, right? Like, everyone ends up changing, right? Like, no one I've brought in has not evolved beyond that, right? And it's just like, the fact that our business would kind of continuously perpetuate negative stereotypes of people of color, but the reality is so different, right?
Yeah.
That we had to do something to kind of counteract that. Like, I think we have the power in our business to be so damaging to culture, or to really heal culture and help people understand. And in that moment, I knew we needed to start something that would tell stories on a massive scale, not eat your vegetables or take your medicine type movies, like, let me lecture to you about an issue, but like big movie star driven award winning stuff that was about some real shit that could shape culture. Like, Will and Grace was not medicine, right?
Yeah.
But it shifted culture.
Yeah. Just Mercy, which of course I've seen. I know many here have seen. This is a movie starring Michael B. Jordan and Jamie Foxx, based on the memoir of Bryan Stevenson, one of my absolute heroes, and his work getting an innocent man off death row. Tell us how the film came together and what the reaction's been so far.
The film was already being developed. A great producer named Gil Adler had found the material. He brought it to Michael B. Jordan. Michael B. Jordan came on as a producer and the star to play Bryan Stevenson, who has been one of my heroes. Like, I've been following Bryan's work, and I've been enamored with Bryan for the longest time.
Incredible.
And it was set up at Warner Brothers. And Warner Brothers was interesting, because most studios are wanting, you know, Iron Man 12 and Fast and the Furious 10 and all of this stuff, right? And
to Hangover 4.
Yeah. And for Warner Brothers to really bet on this film and deeply want to tell the story, because of that's who they are as a company, that's their corporate culture.
And did that take a lot of convincing, or they were just all in?
No, they were all in. There's a really passionate executive there named Nyjah Kirkendall, and she was all over it, brought it to the president, CEO, head of production, and they were in. So we were lucky to come to the party, and really why we were coming in as executive producers and co-financiers was both to invest in the film, but also to use the film to make tremendous impact. And so we started a campaign called Represent Justice around the release of the film. So the studio had their traditional marketing campaign, but we really were like, how do we use a huge movie that's being released around the globe by Warner Brothers, where they're going to spend tens of millions of dollars to market it, to really drive people, once they see the film, to get engaged and make impact. Mm-hmm. And there's been cool things. During the whole fall, we did about a dozen governor screenings, where I literally got to go sit next to a governor who controls the entire incarceration system of a state, and be there. And 9 out of 10 times, that governor would be crying, would need tissues. And then afterwards, you sit with a governor, a chief executive of a state, and say, okay, what bill are we going to run together this year, right? Like, what are we going to do to reduce mass incarceration? Like, the David 300-year-to-life sentence, we're working in multiple states right now to end that practice using all that we have built around Just Mercy.
I think it's such a great first film because it's not just, you leave with, and this, it's not too much of a spoiler, but one of the last scenes in the movie, you get this stat that we're basically wrong on death row, is it 1 in 9 or 1 in 10? And like, Goldman, right, we're numbers focused. Like, that error rate would be acceptable in no
part
of the world ever.
Brian and EJI represent, I mean, they've gotten, I think, 150 clients out who were innocent. Like, 150 people that may have been executed. I mean, Texas, it's pretty apparent to everyone now that Texas has actually executed an innocent man in Cameron Todd Willingham.
Yeah.
Like, and we're actually executing innocent people at this point, but I think it's important, like Brian Stevenson always says that mercy's not just for the innocent, right? And so in Just Mercy,
Yeah, that's fair. Next
in the cell next to him is Herbert, who committed a horrible crime.
Yeah.
But you see his humanity, and you experience his execution.
Yeah, Herbert was a Vietnam vet who suffered from really difficult PTSD, and sort of when he returned home, committed a crime in that state.
Yep.
All right, so these are supposed to be lightning round, but you can answer them as
long
as you want. Okay, so favorite film that you did not produce?
Stand By Me. Stand By Me.
Okay, why?
Although
I want more. Why?
I love Coco also.
Oh, good.
Oh, look at that. Everyone loved Coco.
Okay. Favorite moment from The Hangover where pants were on?
I was responsible for most of the photos that were taken at the end of the film over the credits.
Yeah.
And so I think running around Caesar's Palace with like Zach trying to figure out just insanely stupid photos to take was probably the best moments. All those end photos.
Okay.
That's my handiwork. That's how mature I am.
What's the last great book you read?
Not the last, but one that like guides my entire life, The Alchemist by Paulo Coelho.
Oh, good one. Okay, best piece of advice you've ever received?
I think just be 100% authentic. Like, no mask, no posturing, no peacocking. Just like 100% authentic, and
like
that's how I try to live.
Thank you, Scott.